How's everybody this morning? Why don't you stand up to your feet today? We are going to do a few Christmas songs. Who's up for that this morning? Yeah. So we're just going to ease you in. We're going to start with two this week, and we're going to ease you into Christmas. We don't want to just throw you right into Christmas, right? So we don't want there to be Yuletide shock going on out there. So I'm looking forward to this morning worshiping with you guys, and let's just close our eyes for a moment. Let's open this morning with a word of prayer. Father, we give you place in our hearts today. Lord, as this song states, let every heart prepare him room. Lord, I pray that right now every heart in this place would prepare room for you, Lord Jesus, to take up occupancy, to sit on the throne of our heart. Lord, I pray that we would all vacate the thrones of our heart, that we would step aside and allow you, Jesus, to live through us and to lead through us and to show others love and compassion through us. So, Father, over the next several minutes and over the next hour and a half, we give this morning to you as we worship you in spirit and truth and freedom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, I'm going to ask you to put your hands together. Here we go.
Like this.
Here we go.
Oh, 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 whoa.
Every
seated for a minute. I want to take just a few minutes to talk to you this morning about some things going on in our church family. I want to give you a rundown on some things that are on the calendar coming up here pretty soon. As you know, all of our Wednesday evening, unless your small groups have otherwise contacted you and told you something different, we're not doing anything through the month of December, and we'll pick everything back up on Wednesday evenings in our small groups after the first of the year, okay? One of the things that we're always real excited about at Bright Star Church is the Christmas Eve service. And this year, because Sunday night is on Christmas Eve Eve, we're going to do a Sunday night service, and we're going to have a wonderful time. It's usually one of our largest services throughout the year, and we really take the time. These folks up here and some other folks have always gotten involved in making it a real special time together on Christmas Eve. But this year, it's the 23rd. It's going to be right here. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be doing some Christmas decor and finishing up some trim jobs and stuff that's going to happen in here before that time. So make plans to invite friends and family to join us on that evening, Sunday, December the 23rd, okay? So you guys plan on that. Now, another thing that you're going to hear a lot more about over the next few weeks is the Colorado family camping trip, okay? So we are planning to go to Colorado with as many folks in this church that want to go. We're going to camp out up there. There's going to be several options for you. So if you're like, if you don't like camping in tents, but you like glamping, you like RVs, or you like cabins, or you like a hotel 30 miles away and you want to drive up in the mountains every day, then we'll have all those options kind of laid out for you. And the way it's going to look is this: we're all going to travel out there kind of in a big group. And then once we get there, we'll prepare to have a breakfast every morning and dinner every night. And we're going to have a quiet time together, or a time of worship together every morning after breakfast and every evening. So there's going to be those two times that we meet every day. And then around the place where we're going, though, there's so many different things that you can do. You can go trout fishing. There are national parks that are nearby. You can just anything you want to do. If you want to hike, whatever, we'll have group outings together if you want to go with a group. Or you and your family can just hop in your car and go do whatever you want to do and then meet back with the church family whenever you feel like it. So you have complete and total freedom, but we're really excited about that. There will be essentially a per-person fee for food, for the breakfast and the dinner, and that's really it. Everything else is going to be kind of on you and how you plan as a family to head out there, okay? So we'll have more and more details about that coming up over the next few weeks. Some videos, I'll show you pictures and stuff about where we're headed, and we want to invite you guys to go ahead and make plans to come with us. That is July the 21st through the 27th of summer 2019. So you guys plan on doing that. We're going to have an amazing time, I promise. It's going to be really great. Now, two major prayer requests for our church family this morning. As you all know, many of you may not know, the Higgins family, their house burned this week. And so we have been praying for them, and we want to offer opportunity to just love on their family. I've talked to Rick, and he said as soon as we find out something that y'all can help us with right now, he said basically insurance is covering most everything, and they're taken care of on food and that sort of thing. So we had the idea of going to Walgreens or Walmart, and they sell these little vanilla reloadable cards that you can get, like Visa cards. And you guys as a family can pray about how much you want to give to help. But what that allows them to do is they can use that card for food. They can use it for gas, for clothing, for building supplies, whatever they need to use the money for. They have the freedom to do that, okay? So we're going to, throughout the week, y'all pray about that. Next Sunday, bring the cards in. We'll put them all together, and then we'll give that to the family. Now, there was another family in town. Many of you guys know the McGraws. And they are actually, he's on staff at Shannon Oaks, a wonderful family. Their house also burned this week. And so I don't know. I know some of you guys have been in that situation, how devastating it can be. Obviously, we're very, very thankful that there was no loss of life. I do know that that the McGraws lost a few of their pets, and many of you know that's very difficult because you love your pets just like family. But we're very grateful that there was no loss of life as far as in the family's concerned. Would y'all keep both the Higgins family and the McGraw family in at the top of your priority list as far as prayers this week? And we will continue, again, we'll help them any way we possibly can. But as a church family, we want to present to them those cards. We feel like that's the best way to do it, and it allows them the freedom to do what they want to do. So please continue to pray for them. Now, also, in our community today, the loss of a Celie Blair Stout, a four-year-old little girl that many of you guys have been praying for throughout the year, and she went to be with Jesus the other day, and they're having her services today at 2 o'clock at First Baptist Church. So if you guys know the family and you didn't know that, that's where the services will be held today. And we just want y'all to keep all those folks in prayer. This time of year is a time of celebration, and when you have something like that happen, loss in the family or loss of your home, it can really be devastating and really be hard. So please continue to lift those families up. Now, as far as on the immediate list today, what's going on, we still want to invite you guys out to the last showing today of the Cotton Patch Gospel. How many of you guys have seen the show so far? Yeah, what'd you think? You like it? All right, so you would encourage everybody else. If you haven't seen it, 2 o'clock today, y'all go take the time. Thank you. You're in it. That doesn't count. Take the time to go see that today. It's a whole lot of fun, and today's the last showing, so we want to invite all of you guys out to do that. Now, last but certainly not least, I just want to let you know that through November and December, every church across the country, they are dealing with a tightening of the belt, okay? Because as December approaches and Christmas approaches, most people will kind of tighten their own belt as they prepare for Christmas. All I'm going to say is this. Remember your church family as you are praying about giving this Christmas season. And just remember that, you know, we have commitments here at the church. And I'm talking to our church family, the ones who said, yeah, we're part of this team, we're part of this family. Would y'all please pray about that and pray about what God would have you give faithfully through this period to get us through January. Now, the other thing I want to mention to you that we are really, really excited about, and just put this as a little dot on your radar, and I'm almost finished here, okay? In February, we're going to have what's called Tim Tebow's Night to Shine. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with what that is, but it's basically like a prom night. Okay, it's like a prom night for special needs kids and anybody special needs. And what we're going to do is we're going to transform our gym into a beautiful just ballroom. And we're going to invite all the special needs kids in the area and all the special needs families to come here. And that is going to be their night to shine. We are going to love on them with the love of Jesus. It's the 8th. Is it wrong on the slide? Okay, so it's the 9th? Okay, so it's February 8th. So just put that on your calendar and prepare in your hearts and minds that's going to be a night that we really have an opportunity to love on people in a way that's pretty rare. The team, what I found out is the team will actually, who's going to help put it together, you'll get to have conference calls with Tim Tebow. He'll get on the phone with you and kind of thank you and share with you some different things. So if you like Tim Tebow, I know it's like people out there either love him or hate him, but I love him. I think he's a great guy, and what he's doing for the kingdom is amazing. So y'all keep that in your prayers as we prepare. Why don't you stand to your feet right now, and we are going to continue in a spirit of worship this morning.
I lay my burdens at your feet.
I'm sorry, y'all. I've got the wrong chorus written on me. There we go. Yeah, it's coming. Sorry, y'all. Here we go.
I lay my burdens at your feet. I'm letting go of all the things I can't control.
lay my burdens. I lay my burdens at your feet. I'm letting go of all things I can't control. In my frailty, Lord, I find your strength. I am depending on a love that won't let go. I trust you. I trust you. I trust you. Oh.
Good morning, everybody. It's such a joy to see you all in here this morning. It's I'm supposed to be a tough cattle rancher, and I just can't help but tear up with a beautiful song like that. And so it's what a lovely God we serve, right? I just want to encourage you before I tell you why I'm up here this morning, that if you read John 10:10, it's a pretty well-known verse, and I know through talking with a lot of you, we are struggling with some illnesses and some bangs. You know, Mike fell off his the ladder the other day, and Paul has got a sore back, and just a few others have got aches and pains. And just go to that verse and remember that it says that the thief comes to, he comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus came so that we may have life, and we may have it abundantly. So don't, you know, the devil's here to, just remember that he's here to tear you down and beat you up and make you feel sorry for yourself, but just take your aches and pains to the Lord. Give them to him. We sang about his yoke being stronger than ours this morning, so just remember that. So I just wanted to encourage you about that. We're going to take a little break here now. We call it our BRB time, which stands for Be Right Back, which is about a 7-minute break, and which is now 6 minutes because I've babbled on. Go and grab a cup of coffee, hug a neck. It's a time that we just do here. It's something special we'd like to do in Bright Star. We have a very, very special church family, so make sure you get around, hug necks, and just love on people, because I think that's what one of the big things that makes our church family so special. So do that. Don't forget, we have a couple of places where we can put our tithes and offering right at the front door at the coffee station. Please don't forget to do that. There's also some stations where we can take communion, and I encourage you, if you're hurting with aches and pains this morning, go and take communion and ask Christ to heal you, because that's when we take of his blood and the bread, just remember what he did for us. And so do that this morning. I'm going to be quiet now, and we'll come back in about 6 minutes. God bless you all.
I say give him 7 minutes, Jeff. We'll let him hang for seven.
Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring, ting, tingling too. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. Outside the snow is falling and friends are calling you. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. Giddy up, let's go, let's look at the shore, riding in a wonderland of snow. Giddy up, it's grand, just holding your hand. We're gliding along with the song of a wintry fairyland. Our cheeks are nice. So sweet and clear, when heaven's light and music fell and mercy found us here. Glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the angels sing.
His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, for all eternity. Oh, His name shall be. He came to lift the weary ones, give peace and perfect rest, to take away our burdens and to give a glorious gift. So glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the world will sing. His name shall be called
Good morning. All right. Well, as you find your way to your seats, I will sort of introduce today's sermon. It's on giving. If I can get he's still messing with sound up there, but this is not what I'm comfortable with. I'm an expositor. I'm comfortable expository teaching, which is where we go to one particular passage in the Bible and I just preach right through it. That's what I like to do. That's what I'm comfortable doing. I'm just a teacher and I like to depend on the curriculum, and this is the curriculum God gave us, so I just like to stick to it. But today I'm going to do something that God's stretching me, I guess. He wants me to, or he's led me to do this, and it's going to be a topical sermon. So we're going to be all over the Bible this morning. If you want to put a finger in 2 Corinthians 8, that's our main passage, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, because that's where Paul is writing to the Corinthians about giving. But I want to kind of to deconstruct some of the ideas that we already have about giving. And so to do that, I need to go throughout the whole Bible. I need to start from the beginning and work my way forward. It reminds me of a story. There was these three pastors. It was a young pastor, sort of a middle experienced pastor, and then an elder pastor. And they were all discussing the topic of giving, specifically the idea of how much the church gave every week, how much they should keep for themselves to live on. And the young pastor said, well, I am a very faithful person. I like to depend on faith, so I make it an order of faith. I don't just do a percentage. I go to my office where nobody can see me, and I draw a circle on the floor, and I take all the givings from Sunday, and I say a prayer, and I throw them up to God. And I depend upon my faith, and I depend upon Him to divinely direct that money. And whatever lands inside the circle belongs to God. And whatever lands on outside the circle, then that's mine. And the middle pastor kind of shook his head and says, you know, one day you'll have as much faith as me. Because I don't do it that way. I do it with much more faith. I go in there and I draw that circle. And I throw the money up to the Lord and I say a prayer. And I depend on him to divinely guide that money. And whatever lands inside the circle is mine. And whatever lands outside the circle, I give to the Lord. That's his. And the elder pastor kind of looked at him and smiled and said, one day you'll have enough faith as me. Because what I do is I don't draw a circle at all. I go in there. I take all the givings for that Sunday. I throw them up in the air, and I have faith that whatever the Lord wants, he'll keep. Just so you know, that's not how we do it here. Okay. All right. So, giving. Christianity is a religion and a philosophy based on one person, one being, Jesus Christ, God, and specifically Jesus Christ, and to be like Jesus. And he told us that there are only two principles that the whole Bible is based on, and that is loving God and loving others. And then he said, I'm going to define that love for you. In other words, don't define love for yourself. Love as I love. And he defined his love by one thing, giving. God means, one of the names of God is Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide, or Lord the giver, or the Lord will give. God gave man life. Then he gave man a garden. Then when man sinned, he gave him a covering. Then when man had faith, Abraham, he gave him righteousness. Then he gave him, through Moses, the law. Then he gave the nation of Israel the land. And then he gave the whole world blessings through Israel. That was the reason he established Israel, was to bless the entire world through Israel. And then he gave us hope. And then in John 3:16 it says, he loved us so much that he what? Gave his only begotten son, so that we should have eternal life, another gift. And then in John 14:26, God gave us the Holy Spirit. God is a God of giving. But when I first brought up giving, you thought it was going to be about your giving, right? That's our mindset when we think about giving. Oh, he's going for my pockets, right? Yeah, right. Well, listen, I don't know what the finances of this church are. I'm not involved. This is not a sermon to try to get you to give more. I don't have a clue. This is what the Lord taught me to preach on, and I hope it's freeing. That's the purpose of this today, is to free you from maybe some of the ideas I've had, and some of the ideas maybe you have. First of all, let's establish a simple fact, and that is that God does not need our money. Everybody turn to Psalms 50. In your Bibles today, Psalms 50. I know you went to 2 Corinthians, but just leave your bookmark there. Psalms 50. Here, we're going to start in verse 7. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. This is God speaking to Israel. O Israel, I will testify against you. I am God, your God. I will not rebuke you for your sacrifices or your burnt offerings, which are before me continually. I will not take a bull from your house, nor goats out of your folds. He's saying, I don't need your stuff. Why? The next verse tells us why. For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know all the birds of the mountains, and all the wild beasts in the fields are mine. Not yours, mine. Verse 12 really shook me when I read it. By the way, the pastor gave me way too much time to prepare for this sermon, so it's long. I'm sorry. Here we go. Verse 12, here we go. This one blew me away. If I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. God says, if I was hungry, I wouldn't even bother to tell you about it. Why? Next verse, the next part tells me. For the world is mine in all its fullness. And even more than that, then he goes into like a rhetorical question. I'm God. Do I eat the flesh of bulls? Do I drink the blood of goats? No, those are things I create, not things I need. And then verse 14, the point of this whole psalm, by the way, verse 14, offer to God thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is about us thanking God for what he has given to us and for the power that we have to be like God in our giving. That's where we're going this morning. So if the Lord doesn't want our money or need our money, what does he want from us? Does he want anything from us? Yes, he does. Look at we're going back to 2 Corinthians now. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart. I'm sorry if this offends some of you, but this does not say give 10% of whatever you have. This says what? Let each one give as he purposes in his heart. Not grudgingly, that means not out of obligation, and not of necessity. For God loves a cheerful giver. He wants our heart. He's always wanted our heart. He wants to turn our heart into something like him. He wants to transform our hearts, right? Into him. And what is he? He is a giver. So he wants us to be a cheerful giver. So let's look at tithes. So I made a little disparaging remark about tithes, and some of you finance people are looking at me with mean eyes, but let's look at what the Bible says about tithes. Not the Bible. Let's look at what we say about tithes as Christians. Do we have the next one up there? There we go. This is a study I found. This was a culmination of several actual surveys and studies. It was in Relevant. I think this is in Relevant magazine is where I finally found it. I have the reference from one of the, Relevant magazine. And so it said that 10% of members of the church actually give 10% of their income. Only 10% of church members give 10% of their income. Exceptional church, that's sort of the average. Exceptional churches, in other words, the best churches, 25% of the members actually give 10% of their income. Church-attending Christians, on average, give 2.5% of their income. Now, the surprising fact that this article went into was that this, as long as records have been kept, they looked at, like, the history of church. And this is the, like, average for all of that. Then it said, it made a comment that during the Depression there were dips and during the Recession there were dips. But in general, over the history of time, church has not given 10% of its income. Okay? We are not good tithers as a whole. But let's see what the Bible says about it. Should we be? Well, let's see. The first instance of the tithe in the Bible is in Genesis 14:20. And that was when Abraham had won this battle, got a bunch of loot, was on his way back, and ran into Melchizedek. Melchizedek is a type of Christ because he's a priest and a king. And he ran into Melchizedek. Because he was a man of God, Abraham gave him a tithe of the proceeds, of the loot, the battle treasure. 10%. A tithe means a tenth. He gave him a tenth. Now, interestingly enough, in that passage, if you read through it, there is no requirement from God to Abraham to do that. God did not tell Abraham to give Melchizedek 10%, nor did Melchizedek demand 10%. This was a free will offering from Abraham. That's the first instance of a tithe. It was a free gift. It was a free will gift by Abraham. Now, does that mean there is a required tithe? Okay, so let's look at that. That's in Leviticus 27:30-31, just jot it down. I'm not going to read them all. But that's where the Levitical tithe is established by Moses. He's dividing up the tribes into 12 tribes of Israel, and one of those tribes is going to be the Levites, and they are not going to get to own any land. They're going to work in the temple. They're going to be the ministers to the people, and they're not going to be able to own land or produce any type of food for themselves. So as a provision for them, he told the other 11 tribes to set aside a tenth of everything that they got, and that they should then bring that to the church and give it to the Levite tribe, okay, to the temple, and give it to the Levite tribe. That's called the Levitical tithe. It is the first required tithe in the Bible, and that's where we base our idea of tithing on, right there. But there's a problem with that. right off the bat in those verses. It says, if you have, this was, they were supposed to bring 10% of everything they made, everything they produced, the fruits, the cattle, the lambs, 10% of that. But if you needed to, because you lived too far away or just out of convenience, you wanted to make that money instead of what you produced, then you had to add a fifth to it. It wasn't just 10%, it became 15%. So right off the bat, our idea of tithing is a little, we need to bump it up to 15 if we're going to go by the Levitical tithe. But that's not quite all of it either. You see, Deuteronomy 14:22 establishes the festival tithe. Once a year, everybody was supposed to bring a tenth of everything they produced, in addition to what the Levitical tithe, and bring it to Israel and have a big party. Bring it to Jerusalem, and have a big party, big festival. And you were supposed to celebrate with that tenth. That was a festival tithe, and it was to go for everyone. It wasn't you weren't just to bring your 10% and party on your 10%. Everybody would bring 10% and share it equally, and have a big family reunion right there in Jerusalem. Okay. Then there was, that's not all, because then every 3 years there was supposed to be a local festival, okay, that you had to bring 10% to. And then every 7 years you had to, it was a requirement that you had to release all your debt, so you had to prepare for that and set that aside. And then every seventh year there was to be a Sabbath year where you didn't produce anything, so you had to set aside money for that too. And this is required, okay? So if you add all that up, that's about 37%. Yeah, I understand, Pastor, but I just wanted to go by the Levitical tithe, okay? Okay, but then we have a problem when we get to Malachi 3:8, which is the passage I have heard over and over in my life and has caused me so much guilt. Let's look at Malachi 3:8. Will you rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, how have I robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be a flood in my house. And try me on this. Test me, says the Lord of hosts, and I will open up the windows of heaven and pour out such blessings that there will not be room enough for you to receive it. Anybody heard that preached on before? Anybody ever heard that preached on where they focus on the S in tithes? You see, this isn't about the Levitical 10%. This is about all the tithes, plural. The 37%. So if you're thinking that you're going to get this blessing or this curse, if you don't do it, it's 37%, or roughly. I can't afford that, can you? Maybe some of us can. I hope that you can. That's a blessing. But I can't. I want to free you this morning. All these tithes and offerings ended in 70 AD. Nobody was able to do the Levitical and the law tithes after 70 AD because there was no temple to bring them to. There were very few Levites left anyway. But there was no temple to bring them to after 70 AD, and these tithes were not made after 70 AD. That was the fulfillment of that curse that God is talking about there. But are we still bound by that? Well, let's talk about even before the New Testament. Let's look in Chronicles. Let's look at the beginning of all this. 1 Chronicles 29:1 through 9. This is a long passage. I'm going to skim over it, but it's worth going back and reading because it's amazing. But this is where King David is getting, his son has gotten the go-ahead to build the temple, and King David is giving to the building of the temple. You know, King David wasn't allowed to build a temple. He said, no, this is for somebody else because you did wrong. And so King was like, okay. And so God gave permission for his son Solomon to build a temple. So here's a list of all the stuff that King David gave. And it's gold and bronze and iron and stones and all different. I mean, just lists it over and over and over and over and over and over and over. And it says, and like talents of gold. I mean, that's a lot. And it just goes on and on and on all the way through verse 6. And then in verse 6 it says, then the leaders of the fathers' houses and the leaders of the tribes of Israel and the captains of thousands and hundreds and officers, in other words, anybody in leadership whatsoever, they also gave. Look at the end of verse 6, though. How did they give because the king made them? They offered it willingly. Verse 7, then they gave for the work of the house of God 5,000 talents of this and 10,000 talents of that, all the way through verse 8. And it gets down to verse 9, and it says, what does it say in verse 9? And then the people rejoiced. Why did they rejoice? For they had offered it willingly. Not out of obligation, not because some pastor told them they were supposed to give 10%, or because their parents brought them up that way and they feel guilty if they don't give 10%. No, they rejoiced because they had offered it willingly. Because with a loyal heart, we're still in verse 9, because with a loyal heart, they had offered willingly to the Lord. And King David also rejoiced greatly. Again, God wants a willing, giving heart. Now, why? Or what is the source of this giving? Verse 11 through 13, the same chapter, 11 through 13. It says, O Lord, you are great. The power, this is just a praise to the Lord, just goes on, verse 11. The victory and the majesty for all of the heaven and all of the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O God, and you are exalted above all. Both riches and honor come from you. We should give willingly. We should give with a willing heart because everything comes from God. This is established in the Old Testament, not the New Testament. It's all God's anyway. Deuteronomy 8:18, all money comes from God. And even the New Testament, Philippians 4:19, and God shall provide and supply you with everything you need according to his riches. Romans 12:1 really drives it home for me, and that is that we are living sacrifices. Not just, we think about that and we're like, yeah, I know, I really need to tell people about Jesus. No. We are living sacrifices. Everything that we have, everything that we do, everything that we think, everything that we own, everything that we work hard for, our entire paycheck is a sacrifice to the Lord. All right, so enough about that. Let's look at the tithe in the New Testament. Everybody, please turn to this passage. Matthew 17, verse 24. We're skipping around a lot, but this is a really important one. Matthew 17, verse 24. This is Jesus and Peter. Well, it starts off with just Peter and a guy. The word tithe is really not in the New Testament at all. But here it is, it's working out. You see, the Jews always took what the Lord told them, and then they created laws based on that. And it was called Judaism, and it was very restrictive and harsh. And, you know, God says you're not supposed to work on Sunday. Oh, well, then you're not supposed to even walk on Sunday. You know, I mean, they just take it to the extreme. And so instead of a tithe, they developed a tax. And this is what is going on here in verse 24. When they, this is the disciples and Jesus, had come to Capernaum, those who received the temple tax came to Peter and said, does your teacher not pay the temple tax? That being Jesus. And look what, Peter, one of my favorite disciples is Peter, because he's always, he acts first and thinks about it later, you know. And he says, yes. He didn't go ask Jesus. He didn't double check. He didn't ask Judas, who was the treasurer at the time. He just said, yes, he does. And then he went to ask Jesus. Then he came into the house where Jesus was, but Jesus has anticipated what was going on. Jesus knew what was going on. And so Jesus says, what do you think, Simon? From whom do the kings of this earth take customs and taxes? From their sons or from strangers? Now, what he was saying there about strangers, he just means people outside the family, outside the royal family, right? Citizens of the kingdom. Who pays taxes? The royal family or the citizens of the kingdom? Peter responded, well, from strangers, verse 26, from strangers, from the citizens. Now, look at what Jesus says next. Yeah, it is good. Thank you. It's encouraging. Jesus says, the sons are free. The sons are free. Again, I would like to call your attention to a little bitty letter, the S. Not the son is free. The sons are free. Why did he say that? Because we're adopted into the family. We are citizens of the kingdom only in the sense that we belong to the kingdom as adopted family members, right? We're family. The tax isn't on us. We're free. But then what does Jesus do? Verse 27. Nevertheless, lest we offend them, Peter, because you already told them we'd pay it, go to the sea and cast your hook and take the fish that comes out first and open his mouth, and you will find a piece of money. Take that and give it to them for me and you. This is essentially your weird uncle pulling a quarter out of your ear at Thanksgiving, right? Except he didn't pull a quarter out of Peter's ear. He could have. He could have just reached in his pocket and pulled out the money, right? Miraculous. I mean, why did he make it appear down in the water? Why did he tell Peter to go to work? Because Peter was a fisherman. Why did he tell Peter to go to work? Who got the fish? Peter. He says, okay, go pay the temple tax out of the bonus you get from your work. You know, go work, and then, you know, it's the blessing of the Lord, the stuff that's on top. But you see, Peter was blessed with a fish. I thought, when I saw that, I thought that was really cool. The Lord showed that to me. I was like, Peter got the fish. Plus, he got the blessing of fishing, which I think is a blessing, but I don't fish for a living. Peter may have looked at it a little differently, but he got the blessing of going fishing. Look at, I'll just show you, Acts 4:34. Nor was there, this is a description of the early church, and it says, nor was there anyone among them, this is the church at the time, this is brand new church, very first instance of the church right here, it had just been established, and this is a description of how things were working. It says, nor was anyone among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed them to anyone who had need. Now, I don't want you to hear this as a big commune where they just went and sold everything they had, and then they were poor the rest of their lives, and they just tried to live off the proceeds of that. A lot of cults have done that, and it doesn't work. Money goes quickly. This is a continual thing. And this is in a continual tense, the verb is. In other words, these are people who had things, and they were constantly buying and selling. And when they would sell something, they would take the profit of that, and they would distribute it to whoever had need. But it was a continual thing. They were continually sharing with each other whoever had lack and whoever needed something. But there is no part in Acts 4:34 that says we should be doing that. There's no command, and now you do that, right? The point was is they did it out of gratitude and out of freedom, out of the faithfulness of their heart. It was a free will thing. It was a free will offering. It wasn't commanded. 2 Corinthians 8, that's where you should have your little bookmark in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. Let's go back there and look at verse 14. For if there is a willing mind, it is accepted according to what one has and not according to what one does not have. For I do not mean for others to be eased and for you to be burdened, but there to be an equality. That now at this time, your abundance may supply someone else's lack, and that their abundance may also supply your lack. And that there be an equality, because we are all equal in the sight of God. We all are valuable to God. He's not saying, I don't want you to go put yourself into poverty just so that, for somebody else. That's not what I'm telling you to do. I'm telling you that out of your abundance, give to others and provide for your brothers and sisters. That's what he's telling them to do. That doesn't mean that if you're too poor to give, that there's not a blessing for you also in giving. Look with me, if you will, in Mark 12:41. This is Jesus again. He's in the temple, and he says, Jesus sat opposite of the treasury and saw how people put money into the treasury, and many who were rich put in much. Then one poor widow came and threw in 2 mites. That's the smallest amount of money that you could, like, it's like pennies to us. And put in 2 mites, which make quadrants. And so he called his disciples to himself and said to them, assuredly, I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all those who have given to the treasury. For they all gave out of their abundance. Now, he's not condemning them for giving out of their abundance. He's just saying that she gave more. Why? Because she gave out of her poverty. And that she gave all that she had, even her livelihood. This was money for food, essentially. And she gave out of poverty. So there's a blessing from God even to give out of poverty. Because why? Because the Lord wants us to have a giving heart. He wants us to have a giving heart. So Paul is not saying there's any commandment to give out of poverty, but there is a blessing to give out of poverty. The commandment is that we give out of our abundance. When we have extra, we provide it and we give it to each other. That's the directive to the church. And it, again, and it gets quoted in 2 Corinthians 8. Go back to 2 Corinthians 8, 15, and he quotes the Old Testament here. He who gathered much had nothing left over, and he who gathered little had no lack. That's Exodus 16, 18, he's quoting. So what is it in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 that he does tell the church to do? Let's just get down to the brass tacks here. Okay. Giving should be a response to need. 2 Corinthians 8, 1 through 4. Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that there is a great trial and affliction, the abundance of their joy, and the deep poverty that is abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and even beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. That's exactly what Michael did here this morning. He stood up in front of you and he said, hey, this is a thin time for the church. Please pray about giving. We need to pay our bills in December just like we do in November. So, you know, he's got it before you and has stated a need. He also tells you about other needs of people in the community, the Higgins and the McGraws and spiritual needs where the Seeley baby, right? So we give out because and as a response to need, just like Jesus gave to us. Out of response to need, 2 Corinthians 8, 9, where it says, For you know that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he was rich, and yet for our sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might be rich. Okay? So Jesus is our example. And Paul is making a point that even though this was Jesus spiritually becoming poor for us, but he is talking about that as far as giving is concerned. In chapter 8, verse 9. All right. So, giving should be out of response to need. Number two, amount should be personally determined. Not determined by the pastor or the finance committee. Okay? Amounts should be personally determined by you and your family. 2 Corinthians 8, 3, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 7. It says, so let each one give as he purposes in his heart. I'm here this morning. I want to free you from this idea that you have to feel guilty if you're not giving 10% of everything that you make. The Lord doesn't want you to feel guilty. And if you do give 10% of everything you make, you shouldn't feel prideful. It's not yours. It's God's, right? All of it. Look at your finances. Pray about it. Ask God. And then to purpose in your own heart what you will give. Leave the guilt behind. Be free from that. Please. What you give should be proportionate of what God gives you. In other words, don't put yourself in debt in your commitment. Now, you are free to commit whatever. I'm just saying that the Bible says you should give out of your abundance. And in 2 Corinthians 8, 7 through 14, he says, for I do not mean that you should be eased and for others should be eased and you should be burdened, right? We went over that passage already. He's not saying that you need to commit to something you can't physically commit to. If you say, I'm going to give $200 a month, $200 out of every paycheck, I'm going to give to the church. But you know you can't afford to do that. Well, guess what? The church is not going to come foreclose on you. Right? So what bill is going to get paid? The bills that will foreclose on you. And what's not going to get paid? Well, the $200 you committed to giving to the church. That's just natural. That's just practical. Commit to what you can give. Look at it. Pray about it. Commit to what the Lord wants you to commit to. Now, if the Lord says you need to have faith, then, you know, I'm going to provide for you, commit a little more. That's between you and the Lord. But don't let the church or anybody standing in front of you to make you feel guilty, or somebody from your past or what you've been taught in the past to make you feel guilty for what you've chosen to give a purpose in your heart. Okay, because that's what the Lord has directed you to do. Because why? Because the Lord is after your heart, not your money. He wants you to have a giving heart. He wants you to feel good about giving. Now, it doesn't mean it shouldn't hurt a little bit, because your money should not be the most important thing in your life. And maybe the Lord wants you to give a little more because he doesn't want you to be greedy. Some people, you know, some people are different. The Lord's working on you in different ways. But he's after your heart, not your money. He wants you to have a giving heart. And how do we do that? We pray. We ask God, how much should I commit out of my paycheck? Maybe it's a percentage. Maybe your income is not steady. Maybe it floats with your business, so you give a percentage. Maybe it's steady, and you just say, well, every month when I pay my bills, I'm going to pay $200. Okay. 2 Corinthians 9:3 and 1 Corinthians 16:1-3 talks about giving through the church and for the church's needs, that it's appropriate to do that. It is appropriate to give to the church. They got to go to play. Good luck. Break a leg. Prepare in advance your tithe. So it talks about 1 Corinthians 16:1-3. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must do also. On the first day of the week, let each of you lay something aside. Not give 10%, but lay something aside, right? Lay something aside, storing up as he may prosper out of your profit, that you that there'll be no collection when I get there. In other words, I'm not going to get there and burden you. This is something that you are doing, that you're deciding to do. All right. I'm going to wrap it up here quickly. Almost done. It's getting late. Getting hungry, right? Okay. But this is the good stuff right here. Luke 16:1-14 says that when you, that whole story, it's really good to read. I'm not going to go through it. But that's a story where Jesus says, basically, he says, take your money, and when you give it to the people of the world, non-Christians, when you're giving money to non-Christians, do it in a way and understand that you are investing in them eternally. You're giving to them to give glory to God so that they may come and partake of eternal life. That's why we give to the poor. We do that all the time. We have community outreach. We did last week with Be the Service, where we go out into the community and give to the community in order that they may see how giving God is and want to be a part of it. But even more than that, turn in your Bibles, please. Last time I'll make you turn in your Bibles. Proverbs 19:17. Read it for yourself. Proverbs 19:17. He who has pity on the poor, that means anybody with a need, he who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord, and he will pay back what has been given. When we give to each other in need, we are not investing in that person. We are investing in God. That's awesome. That's freeing, right? I don't have to worry about somebody paying me back. I'm going to leave that to, no, I'm giving it to you. I'm loaning it to God. He's going to pay me back. Maybe not in this life, but, you know, he provides everything. He provided it for me in the first place. So I don't want it back. I'm giving it to you, and it's an investment in God. And that's not coming from me. That's coming from the Lord, right? He says, take pity, and he lends to the Lord. But not in just one place. In 2 Corinthians 9:8, he says, and God is able to make grace abound to you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things, that may have an abundance for every good work. Why does he give us an abundance? For every good work. Mark 9:41, for whoever gives you a cup of water to drink in my name because you belong to Christ, assuredly I say to you, he will not lose his reward. He's not going to lose the investment on that cup of water. I know that's on purpose. I want you to see that it's piling up. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, invite the maimed, invite the lame, invite the blind, invite people who have no way of paying you back. And you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, but God will repay you on the day of resurrection. So, New Testament giving. We are free to give, and we are free from required giving. You are not required to give. Let it go. Give freely out of your heart. Give out of your hearts. We love God and we love others by our giving. That's what I want you to take away. And I have one last thing to share with you. And this is an idea I heard when I was in Wisconsin. And so I stole it from the pastor there, but he's okay with that because he stole it from Bruce Wilkinson. It's a great book called You Were Born for This. And it's about practical ways you can invite God to do miracles in your life. And this is a beauty. It's called The God Pocket. It comes from 1 Timothy 6:17 through 18. It doesn't tell you to have a God pocket in this passage, but the principles are there. So 1 Timothy 6:17 and 18 says, command those who are rich in the present age, or in other words, you got some money in the moment, not to be haughty, nor to trust in the uncertain riches, but the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good, that their riches may do good works, ready to give and willing to share. And here's how he says a practical way to do this is to have a God pocket. The idea is to have a place in your purse, an envelope on your body, or just a pocket that is God's pocket. You're saying whatever is in that pocket belongs to the Lord. And then put money in it. That's prepare to give. Okay? So I'm gonna say, I got $5 extra bucks, I'm gonna put it in my God pocket. Lord, that's yours. You tell me what to do with it. I'm putting it in there, it's no longer mine. I have one right here. Just put a little money in there. I don't have a lot yet, but I put a little money in there. And then it says, listen for the prompting. Ask the Lord, Lord, you show me who needs this money. You tell me who needs this money. And I'll listen for it. Now, this isn't to be given to Salvation Army as you walk into Walmart or, you know, or Redeeming Zoe or something like that. No, this is supposed to be like, Lord, show me who, what person. Prompt me to have a conversation with somebody. And then you go over to them and you give God the glory. Somebody gave me this money, and they told me to give it to you. It's not mine, and I can't rightly keep it. They told me to give it to you, so I have to give it to you. Well, thank you, you know, or what? That prompts the conversation, right? And then you say, it was from God. You know, that who's the person that told me to, you know, they're going to ask, who told you to give me this money? Well, the Lord did. Well, I don't want to, you know, they have, you know, I don't want it. I don't need it. Well, then give it to somebody else. It's God's money, not mine. He told me to give it to you. What you do with it is your business. The God pocket. I'm so excited to do this. I'm trying to get as much money in there as I can, so I just want to have that first one to be kind of really good. I haven't had a chance to do it yet, and there's only like $4 in there anyway, so but I'm taking a little extra and putting back, you know. And then it says, prepare to give, listen for the prompt, give the glory to God, and then enjoy the joy of giving. Enjoy the joy of giving. Let him possess your heart. Ask God to fill your heart with his Holy Spirit so that you may become a fountain of giving. Will you pray that with me this morning? Let's pray. Lord, you are the giver. Everything is yours. Thank you so much for giving us your Son. If there's anyone in here this morning who hasn't received that gift that is freely offered, Lord, just have them do it today. It's just easy. All you have to do is say, yes, Lord, I accept your forgiveness. I accept what you did through your Son, Jesus Christ. I accept that. Thank you for giving to me. Make me a giver like you, Lord. If you're praying that prayer for the very first time this morning, if you're accepting Jesus Christ, if you're accepting that gift of forgiveness, please come and talk to me or Benny or Doug about it after church. Just let us know so we can pray with you. And I just do that for us. Take care of that if you haven't done that. Now, for the rest of us, Lord, please make us givers. Fill our hearts, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Remind us that the abundance that we have is because of you and is yours. Fill us with the spirit of giving. Make us givers like you. Teach us to love through our giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all so much. I'm sorry it was so long. But I think it was worth it. Amen. And you are dismissed. Thank you. Go see Cotton Patch this afternoon. Tell me, why do we wait 364 days to slow down and stop? Remember how blessed we are. So we're trading in.